Jeff, this is the perfect day to spend out here in the waters of Lake Champlain in Vermont.
I agree, Ray. The weather's finally getting warmer, and you can't help but want to be out on the lake.
All right, so what are we looking for today?
Well, don't let the still waters of Lake Champlain relax you too much, because we're here searching for a monster that's said to lurk just below the surface. Hi, I'm Jeff Belanger.
And I'm Ray Auger, and welcome to episode 38 of the New England Legends podcast. If you give us 10 minutes, we'll give you something strange to talk about today.
And if you like our stories, please do post a review on iTunes. You know, the Apple Podcast app. Those reviews help us move up in the rankings so our show reaches more legendary listeners like you. And tell your friends. These stories are worth sharing and talking about with others.
All right, Jeff, Lake Champlain. I think I know what we're looking for here.
Do you now?
Well, could it be Champy, the lake monster?
It is. This is one of those stories we've been talking about covering for a while now. But the dilemma's been, how do you discuss a legend this huge in just 10 minutes?
Well, the Loch Ness Monster in Scotland is the most famous lake monster in the world. But New England's version may run a close second at this point. For centuries, people have talked and written about a lake monster lurking in these waters. But do you really think we'll find that creature today?
I know our chances are slim. We're only out here for an afternoon, and while it's possible, I know it's just not likely. But maybe we can accomplish the next best thing and find someone who has seen the creature. There's a sign near Bulwaga Bay on the New York side that displays dozens of names and the date of their champ sightings. It's a place to start anyway.
Well, while we search for a witness, we should set this up. First of all, the lake is huge. It shares the Vermont and New York borders to the lakes east and west, and its north tip is in Quebec. It's 120 miles long, 12 miles at its widest point. It has an average depth of 64 feet and 400 feet at its deepest point. The lake features 435 square miles of surface water.
And that's a lot of water. If we go back over half a millennia to the time when the Abenaki and the Iroquois people lived in this region, we find the earliest accounts of a strange creature in these waters. They called it Tatoskog, which roughly translates to great serpent. It's described as an underwater horned serpent that's known to eat humans.
In July of 1609, French explorer Samuel de Champlain finds this lake and knew because of its size and location along three borders that it would be an important resource for commercial shipping. And that also means it's of military importance. The lake would eventually be named in Champlain's honor.
Excuse me, do you know anyone who's had an encounter with Champ the Lake Monster? No? Hey, Ray, maybe ask those picnickers over there.
Hey, hello, have any of you folks seen Champ the Lake Monster? Okay, got it, no dice.
Man, well, in digging through the newspaper archives, I found plenty of old references. Ray, give this a read. It's from the October 1st, 1886, Pulteney Journal in Vermont.
All right. It says, Lake Champlain's famous sea serpent has again been seen in the vicinity of Plattsburgh, New York. Sunday at 4 o'clock, J.C. Root of Albany and J.J. Benson of Troy, two well-known commercial men, were sitting on the veranda of the Fouquet House, gazing listlessly at the placid water of the bay. All at once, there was a great commotion in the water, some 200 feet from shore. Mr. Benson described the object as being at least 100 feet long, as near as he could judge, and shaped like a porpoise. The back was curved and arched in true sea serpent style. The gentlemen say they have become firm believers that Lake Champlain has a real sea serpent.
That's from 1886.
Wow, 100 feet long.
Here's another article from the April 29th, 1915, Orwell Citizen in Vermont.
This one reads, fearsome creature stranded near Port Henry. After remaining in seclusion for more than 22 years, the Lake Champlain sea serpent has again appeared. He was seen at the 1892 encampment of the American Canoe Association when, coming to the surface in the neighborhood of the flotilla of cruising canoes, he scattered the canoeists in panic. When first sighted through field glasses a few days ago, the serpent, which one observer says was about 40 feet long, was stranded on the reef at the entrance to Bulwaga Bay, near the Crown Point fortifications. Presently, he released himself, and after a few wild plunges which lashed the water into foam, headed for Chimney Point in great circular sweeps, finally sinking submarine fashion, leaving a wake which was well-defined on the glassy surface of the lake.
That's from 1915.
That really is amazing. You said there were more articles?
There's plenty more. Some describe the spikes on the serpent's back. Some said it had the head of a horse, but without the ears sticking up. The newspaper accounts increase as you move further into the 20th century. But something else happens over time.
What's that?
How they label this creature evolved. As you can see from these old newspaper accounts, they called it a serpent for many decades. But then serpent wasn't enough. It became a monster. In 1887, this creature even caught the attention of P.T. Barnum, who offered a $50,000 reward for anyone who could catch this beast, dead or alive.
That's a P.T. Barnum reference 2 episodes in a row now.
Well, thanks for paying attention.
But I get it. The legend is growing. I have a funny feeling I can guess how this serpent makes the leap to monster.
Well, how's that?
In 1933, a photograph is published in Scotland, taken at Loch Ness, and featured a dinosaur-looking head poking out of the water.
The infamous George Spicer photo.
That's the one. Once that photo was published, the media and masses started referring to the unknown lake creature as the Loch Ness Monster. Once word reached America, I'm guessing Lake Champlain locals thought, hey, we've got something just like that right here. Ours is a monster, too.
That's a good point. And no one wants to be left out of a legend. And since the 1940s and 50s, Champ the Lake Monster has become a cottage industry fueled by further sightings, sculptures, paintings, even photographs.
Now, the most famous Champ photograph came in 1977 when Sandy Mancy clicked a picture of a serpent-like creature with its head arched out of the water. Now, that photo is a head-scratcher. When I look at it, I can't help but think of possible dinosaur leftovers. I can see the bent horse-like head, the long snake-like body. It looks like a plesiosaurus that somehow survived extinction from millions of years ago.
It's funny you should mention dinosaurs, Ray, because there's an island on this lake called Isle Lamont on the Vermont side that's home to the oldest known fossil reef in the world. It dates back over 450 million years.
Whoa, so this was dinosaur country?
Maybe it still is.
Way back in episode 16, we explored the story of Cassie the sea serpent from Casco Bay in Maine. I remember us talking about the coelacanth, this fish thought to have been extinct for 65 million years until one was caught by a fisherman in South Africa in 1938.
Right, extinct no more.
Is it possible there's some lake fish equivalent? I mean, something weird that lives in these waters that's freaking people out?
Well, there is something called a garfish in this lake. Take a look at this picture and tell me what you think.
Oh, good God. That thing is ugly. It does look like a monster, though. This one is maybe, 3 feet long? It's got a long snout, kind of like an alligator, and a long body, almost like a real thick snake. But fins at the back.
Down south in Louisiana, there's a version of this fish called the alligator gar. It can grow up to 6 feet long and weigh over 100 pounds, though some claim they can grow as long as 10 feet.
Okay, but no one is going to confuse a 6 or even 10-foot fish with something 40 feet in length, as we've heard Champy describe before. And the garfish has a snout that turns into a regular fish's head. It doesn't look like the head of a horse, and it doesn't look like it can bend downward like a snake can do with its head.
Really? Your dad's seen him? Well, thanks. Ray, I think we may have found a witness.
Oh, that's awesome. I can't wait to hear this.
I'm Stephen Mazurowski. I grew up on Lake Champlain, and in July 1978, my dad and I saw what we called the Lake Champlain Monster.
Stephen Mazurowski is 69 years old now and a retired school teacher. His experience happened in Crown Point on the New York side of the lake. Considering this event occurred less than 2,000 feet from Vermont, we're going to annex Crown Point into New England for this episode.
Stephen explained back in July of 1978 that there had just been a violent thunderstorm that took down some branches and damaged his uncle's camp. So Stephen and his dad went there to take pictures of the damage for insurance. He describes the scene.
The camp itself is up on a rise, and we have a good view of the lake, and it was a day where the lake was like glass. It was very calm, and my father looked over and he said, "Hey, look at that." And I looked out, and just outside the bay where the camp is, there was something in the water traveling, which would be north. And it had a very long and thin wake, which was always important to me because it was like something going through the water instead of on top of the water. And the description of it would be like a horse's head without ears. And my father and I were watching it, and it was traveling quite rapidly. And it came up a little bit, and my dad said, "Hey, look, there's a neck." And there was a boat coming south. And when they got a little close, I'll call it, the head went underwater and never reappeared. The boat went by. Apparently, they saw nothing. And my dad looked at me and said, "Ah, gee, we've just seen the Lake Champlain monster."
Stephen, didn't you say you had a camera?
I was standing there with a camera, which, of course, I never took a picture, but I was out of film. Didn't matter. But that was the source of a lot of teasing, like, why didn't you get a picture?
Oh, it's a tough break for all of us. Turns out Stephen and his dad are just two of hundreds of witnesses who have seen this lake monster.
Champy is an industry at this point. There are Champy plush toys for sale, Champy t-shirts, public sculptures, and even a professional minor league baseball team called the Vermont Lake Monsters. They play in Burlington, Vermont, and they're the farm team for the Oakland A's. Ray, can you guess who their mascot is?
I think I can. And I have to say, I love their team logo. It's a mad-looking cartoon lake monster coming right at you. All this makes me wonder if anyone is trying to prove if the creature is real. I mean, I've seen photos, but how about underwater sonar, video cameras?
Well, there have been multiple studies and more photos and video clips. Some believers say it's Champ. Others claim it's a large garfish. Others shrug and say the jury's still out.
Well, no matter what, this legend has stuck around at least five centuries. That doesn't happen by accident.
No, it doesn't. It takes multiple witnesses over a long period of time for a strange event to evolve into a legend. People who grew up by this lake, like Stephen Mazeroski did, know the story. I mean, sure, the first time you hear it, you scan the waters and you're looking, but after a while of that, you're going to give up. You don't expect to see the monster. Until one day, it happens. And you find yourself unwittingly adding a new chapter into the legend of Champy, the monster of Lake Champlain. Ray, do you think we should bring fishing poles?
Well, if we do that, we're going to need a bigger boat.
Nice. You can listen to the New England Legends podcast on a boat, in your car, on your computer, or anywhere you want to take us. Subscribe for free right through your smartphone so you never miss an episode. You can find us on iTunes, Stitcher, Google Play, iHeartRadio, TuneIn, or wherever you get your podcasts.
If you visit our website at OurNewEnglandLegends.com, you can check out our entire show archive, including photos from most of these locations. See the New England Legends television series on PBS and Amazon Prime, and interact with other legendary listeners.
Until next time, remember, the bizarre is closer than you think. Thank you.